What's going on, everyone? It's Ben here with a new video. In this one, different angle, still terrible lighting. My apologies. I have not invested in lighting and I'm sorry. But we will press on. And we're going to talk about one song today, and we're going to talk about arrangements and how they can really, really impact a song. So what do I mean by arranging? Okay, so imagine you've got your song, all right, and it's the basic chords and the basic melody, right? That's your song. Arrangement is how you twist and turn those certain things to elicit different feelings, different vibes, all of that kind of stuff. You know, I remember when I was at uni, when we were studying arranging, the task every 3 weeks, I think, was find a song, write out a chart for the song, rearrange the song into a style that is completely different, write a chart for that song, get a band together, learn both versions, and then perform them. So I remember I did like Comfortably Numb as like a heavy metal, like about as close to death metal as I can conjure up. What else did I do? I did You're the Voice as like a 12 bar blues, Stevie Ray Vaughan, Texas blues type thing. I can't remember the other one that I did, but there was one more. But we are going to talk about Gravity by Sara Bareilles. Now, for those who know me, you know that I'm just like mildly obsessed with Sara Bareilles, and specifically this song. I think it is one of the greatest pop songs ever written, personally. It's just wonderful in every sense of the word, and I'm, you know what, fuck it, I'm not mildly obsessed. I'm frighteningly obsessed with this song. So we're going to take a look at three versions of the same song, okay? The first version is going to be from Careful Confessions. The second version is going to be from Little Voice. And the third version is going to be from Live at the Hollywood Bowl, which was a recent live album that she did. And we're going to look at how that one song in the same key by the same artist can be changed. We're going to start with the first version, that being Careful Confessions. Now, first thing I want to bring up is instrumentation, okay? So I'm just going to play a section from each of them. Okay, so I'll start with Gravity. It's three versions of Gravity. We'll start with Careful Confessions.
Something always brings me back to you. Takes too long. No matter what I say or do, I still feel you here till the moment I'm gone.
Okay, so that's the first little verse of Careful Confessions. Now, what do we notice? Instrumentation. This is one of the biggies. All right, so the instrumentation. We've got piano, we've got drums. So far, we've of course got vocals. The drums are doing this almost like marching band kind of snare thing, all right? It's really kind of driving everything forward. If we listen to the original version, I say the original version, the Little Voice version, let's see how that section differs, all right?
Something always brings me back to you. It never takes too long.
All right, and that's the gist of that. I'm not going to play anymore because I'll get DMCA'd. So right off the bat, Careful Confessions, we've got drums, we've got vocals, and we get into acoustic guitar and bass and stuff, and I'll play that in a little bit. Little Voice strips all that back. Piano, string section. Very different feel already. So what they've done is they've gone, here are the chords, this is the tempo, this is the feel. How can we make this different? How can we make it feel a certain way? get the string section in, bugger off the drums and the bass. It's not quite the vibe I want. Or whatever, however the conversation went, I don't know. Let's listen to Live at the Hollywood Bowl. Now we're going to notice something interesting right off the bat. Violin solo. Very different beginning to the others. Okay, and I'm just going to stop it there because you should go listen to the whole song yourselves. So that is an arranging trick, all right? Are we going to put a guitar solo in there? Are we going to put a violin solo? Are we going to put a bass solo? What, is there going to be a section where we have solo, improvisatory or written? Are we going to throw that in there? The first two? No. There's no solo. This one, yes, violin solo. It's a very good solo. At least I think it's a violin. I'm not too au fait with stringed instruments other than this stringed instrument. So let's skip forward now to the verse on that song. On that verse, on that fucking arrangement, Jesus.
Something always brings me back to you. Never takes too long. No matter what I say or do, I still feel you here till the moment I'm gone.
There you go. Completely different. Completely different vibe, you know. Same song, same singer. The arrangements, just different. Let's take a look at the first one. We're going to go back to the first one now because we've got a little bit of note choice to talk about, because part of an arrangement is, okay, do I stick to the melody the entire time, or are there moments when I do little kind of bits of ornamentation? It's kind of a yes or a no question, and then if the answer is yes, it is, where do I do it? Why do I do it? And how do I go about it, right? If the answer is no, the answer is why not? You know, these are really kind of cool questions to ask yourself. If you're writing a song and you are struggling with the sound of it, go, maybe I need to do something different with the arranging. This is kind of what this video is about. So let's look at the original again. Let's have a listen to the lyric. Drown in your love, and let's see what happens melodically.
Never wanted anything so much than to drown in your love and not feel your rain.
If we go to the original, I keep getting the versions mixed up. Little voice. If we go to the little voice version, this is what we hear.
I never wanted anything so much than to drown in your.
Simpler, all right? Now the question is, why is it similar? I love that run. I think it's beautiful and it's incredible and it sounds great. I love it. Why did they take it out of, I think, pretty much every subsequent version? I don't know. I wasn't there. But I think I can speculate, because this song is like a very powerful, intimate ballad kind of thing at its core, right? Which is why I think the little voice version kind of did a bit better, because it kind of, for me, gets to the heart of the song a little bit more, even though I love the Careful Confessions version. The extraneous kind of ornamentation and stuff, the melisma, could have been one of those things. We like it, it sounds good, I can do it, but does it serve the song? And everything should serve the song, okay? The biggest ego in the room has to be the song at all times. So you go, do I really need to do that little run? Or is that just me doing a run because I think it sounds good? And that could have been the conversation. It could have been, yeah, Sarah, I think the run sounds great, but I don't think it's the right thing to do, given the vibe of the song. So that's another thing, no choice. Do we fuck with the melody? Do we not fuck with the melody? If we fuck with it, how do we fuck with it? All of those kind of questions. I also want to talk lastly about the kind of build-up at the end of the song, after the bridge. We're going to start again with Careful Confessions. And all over me, I live here on my knees as I try to make you see that you're everything I think I need here on the ground. But you're neither friend nor foe, though I can't seem to let you go. The one thing that I still know is that you're keeping me down. So, what do we have in the bridge? Right, that classic kind of build-up throughout the entire bridge. And then when she comes out of that big solo long note, bang, big crash, big re-entry into the outro, I guess you could call it. Huge, powerful. I personally love that arrangement. I think it's fantastic because the entire song is such a great build and it pays off, if that makes sense. It's like, bang, yes, we've been waiting for that the entire song. Fuck yeah, it's great. The original, let's have a wee listen. The original, again, little voice. Dickhead. And all over me, I live here on my knees as I try to make you see that you're everything I think I need. The opposite, the bridge with the kind of strings going dun 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 dun, doing the same kind of rhythmic thing that was happening, but of course different instrumentation, different vibe. And then the end, when you expect it to kind of explode into this big thing, it doesn't. Kind of subverts your expectation in that way, and I love that. I think that's great. I think it's just spectacular. But then again, I think everything Sara Bareilles does is spectacular. So I'm kind of not one to talk. But it's a cool little arranging trick, right? It's like, oh, do we want to kind of pull the rug or do we want to kind of go with what the expectation is? Let's have a listen to the bridge on the live version. Instrumentation, different arrangement, right? What I should say is the instrumentation does change up in that one. It kind of brings in the drums and the electric guitar, as we heard, right? No acoustic guitar, which is a difference from the Careful Confessions version, and obviously there isn't really electric guitar or drums in the little voice version, so it's almost a hybrid, right? But the build is vastly different. Okay, the come down is kind of like the little voice come down, but the build is, again, it's kind of like an amalgam of both in a way. So really, what this video is about the power of an arrangement. How can we take, you know, this composition that we've made and how can we improve it? How can we bolster it, all right? You look at your instrumentation, you go, Do I want strings? Do I want horns? Do I want a full band? Do I want, acoustic instruments or electric instruments, right? All of those decisions are going to massively impact the overall tone of the arrangement, all right? Even if I play that song, same chords, on an electric guitar, it immediately becomes a different thing, right? If you arrange it for strings to play those same chords, it becomes a different thing. Okay, how do we want the song to feel? Do we want it to be kind of driving? Do we want those drums to be, you know, big and pushing? Or do we want them to come in later on in the piece and just basically do some like tom work, you know, more or less? All these questions, right? So if you're a songwriter, these are the things that you think about, right? Because it can kind of change the song, you know, it can change the genre of the song, it can change a lot of things about the song. What key do you want it in? How much are you going to mess with the melody? How much room is there going to be for improv? You know, obviously the live version of this song is a live version, so there is room for improv, you know, it's the beauty of live music. Go listen to those three versions of the song. Again, I don't know what this video was, I'm sorry, but I hope you enjoyed my ramblings about a cool Sara Bareilles song. But I want you to go listen to those songs and try and pick apart the arrangements. I could go so much further in depth, but we do not have the time, nor do I have the resources to record a 2-hour long lecture on Graffiti by Sara Bareilles, although I would love to. So we'll leave that video there. Let me know if you've got any questions. I hope I can answer them. I hope this video wasn't entirely nonsensical. And I'll see you guys in the next video, whenever that may be. All right, guys. Toodle-pip.